You are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence you won't let go. In the questions your truth will hold. Your brave love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea.
Isn't it awful? It's just awful. Welcome to the Church of the Cold Shoulder. Now, wait a minute. I was thinking about that. With COVID protocol still in place, safe social distancing, we can legitimately call ourselves the Church of the Cold Shoulder. Is that not true? So therefore, we are the Church of the Cold Shoulder, and if that doesn't fix your wagon, how about this one? We've got a warm heart. Does that work? Yeah. So Church of the Cold Shoulder, with a warm heart in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, a place where he is all that we are about. We welcome you into the house of the Lord this morning and thank the Lord for his wonderful work in our midst. Let me call your attention to a number of things. First of all, to those of you who are joining us online. In fact, I had an opportunity to converse with some of you in person the other day. It was classic, talking through a glass door on your garage and so forth. But nonetheless, we were the we were the meeting of the cold shoulders and warm hearts. But if you are part of our online family, we welcome you to Beck's Reformed Church. Whether you're across the street or, dare we say, across the sea, we're in the family of God. Please notice that there are opportunities for fellowship and service which have been sent to you this week in your email bulletin, as it were. They have been scrolling on the screen. I just want to remind you, Sunday school occurs after this service here this morning. You also will be seeing and have received information and will be hearing about a congregational forum on Saturday, 14 November. We'll make full use of all the space we have available to us, because we want to hear from you, and you will have opportunity to do this. Let me think if there was anything else that I needed to announce. I think that covers it all. We don't want any announcements. We want to worship the Lord. As we prepare to bring our hearts to prayer this morning, I want to do two things. First of all, highlight to you that there is a prayer request that have been sent to you this week, and there you see them. I want to add one more to that list that I was asked this week to include, Debbie Seacrest Sink, as I was asked to share that, who has been diagnosed with cancer. Debbie Seacrest Sink. Also would like to highlight as well, about 10 days or so ago, I sent you this document by email. Every one of you should have received it. I hope you read it. I hope you read the cover letter that I wrote with it. And in this letter, which has to do with a prayer focus that we're going to have, I remind you, if we as a church are going to move forward, if we're going to make progress, if we're going to be postured for a vibrant future, we got to have help, because I'm not good enough. Okay, let's just be clear about that. So we're asking God to do something because you got a weak leader. Okay, with that in mind, we're doing that. I asked you to do three things with this document. I asked you to print it out, to keep it, and to do it. I ask you to do that for your sakes, for our sake. And it basically is praying for the glory of God at Beck's. And you see that you are praying for your personal life, for the pastoral staff, which includes myself, Christy, Kevin, and Suzanne. Suzanne, poor thing, she has to put up with me on a daily basis. So pray for Suzanne. Also pray for the church leaders, which is consistory, elders, committees, teams, whomever, and of course for we as a congregation. We're asking God to do something. At the bottom of that, you see a prayer that you hear every week in this place. With that in mind, now let's prepare our hearts for prayer as we open our worship service this morning. And just wanted to share with you, I was thinking this week of the old hymn that we sometimes sing, Sweet Hour of Prayer. I suspect you know it. I'm used to singing it in Hawaiian. But here's what one part of one of the key verses says in English. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, that calls me from a world of care. In seasons of distress and grief, my soul has often found relief and oft escaped the tempter's snare by thy return, sweet hour of prayer. Let's seek the Lord right now. Gracious God, we thank you that in these hours that we can gather in your name, that you are here in this place. And it is an opportunity for us to say, we need you. We are frail. World and life and ourselves sometimes get bigger than us. And we thank you that nothing is bigger or greater or wiser than you. And so in this moment, we lift all of our hearts and lives and concerns before you. You have heard the requests that we have shared with one another and specific names. We lift those folks before you and believe that you are able to work in wonderful ways, showing yourself as a comforter and a healer. That's what Jesus said the Holy Spirit is. And our souls in this season of distress and grief, we're going to find relief because we're turning to you. And so we lift our lives before you. We ask that in this hour of worship, you would make yourself real. Receive our praises. Be glorified and move in our midst. And even continue to mold us and shape us as we pray together our Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'll turn it over to our worship band, which has a wonderful enhancement this morning, wouldn't you say? Marvelous. Let's go.
So our first song that we're doing today is God So Loved, based on John 3:16. Such wonderful words that we have. Again, we love that, Autumn is up here singing with us. Not only does she make us sound a lot better, but she makes us look a lot better.
Amen.
So appreciate so much for coming to sing with us today. God So Loved.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Well, come all you sinners, come find his mercy, come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. We'll live forever. The power of hell, forever defeated. Now it is well. Walking in freedom, for God so loved. God so loved the world. Praise God, praise God.
Please read in unison from the screen the Apostles' Creed as an affirmation of our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived of the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sat at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now we present our offerings and our lives to God as we sing the doxology.
Most heavenly, gracious Father, we give you thanks today for the blessings that you give us each day. Today we have brought our tithes and our offerings. It's just a part of our commitment for you, and we pledge and we guide to guide us in your work in doing what is best in your name. These things we ask in your most holy name. Amen. You may be seated. Our scripture today comes from Ephesians, the 4th chapter, the 4th through the 6th verse, and the 11th through the 16th verse. There is one body and one spirit, just as also you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. And he gave some as apostles, and some as prophets, and some as evangelists, and some as pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints for the work of the service, to the building of the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a mature man, to the measure of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. As a result, we are no longer to be children, tossed here and there by waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men, by craftiness and deceitful scheming, but speaking the truth in love. We are to grow up in all aspects into him who is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body, being fitted and held together by what every joint supplies, according to the proper working of each individual part, causes the growth of the body for the building up of itself in love. This ends the reading of our scripture.
So our song that we're doing today and our special message is a new one out. That's by Chris Tomlin. It's Who You Are to Me. And you might have heard it. They play it a lot out on K-Love, do a lot of different things with it. But I love it because it pulls in a group that's not normally heard out on K-Lot. Usually you hear it out on country music, Lady Antebellum or Lady A now. So this one is a new one, Who You Are to Me. We actually have our own Lady A with us today singing with us. So I hope you enjoy this one and get a lot out of the words and who Christ is to you.
Some people think you're distant, just some words on a page. that you're nothing more than fables handed down along the way. I've seen you part the waters, and no one else could pull me from the deep. That's who you are to me.
Some people think you're just lit in cathedrals made of stone, but I know you live inside my heart. I know that it's your home. And I've seen you in a sunset and in the eyes of a stranger on the street. That's who you are to me.
You're amazing, faithful. Love's open door when I'm empty. You fill me, hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are to me. Who you are to me. You're everything I need. You're amazing, faithful. Love's open door when I'm empty. You fill me with hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are to me.
Who you are.
Who you are. You're forever holy. You're the Lamb who is worthy. My forgiveness, my healer, the Messiah, my Redeemer. You're amazing, faithful. Love's open door when I'm empty. You fill me. Hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are. You are greater, higher, over it all. In your presence, Jesus, I stand in awe of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who.
Two, three, four. Takes a while for the Holy Ghost power to come upon you. Now I've got too much reverb, Holy Ghost, so tune it down a little bit. I wanted to share with you, this is an inside baseball tip here. As you know, we have a problem with people seeking to usurp my authority and position. Last Sunday, Sandra Story would not relinquish the pulpit after the choir sang, and that was a problem. And then this morning, Tyson was to help us with the affirmation of faith. In the back room, we had a discussion. Tyson, when you come up here, you are to sit in the smallest chair up here. Shirley's an elder. She gets to sit here. Nobody sits in the big chair but me. We get up here. Silly looks across over the flowers and says to me, I'm in a bigger chair. And then he was coming for me, and I'm not going to have that. So I'm calling him out right here in front of everybody. Let's pray and be about it. Gracious God, we thank you that we're in a family and that your spirit is working in our midst. And we rejoice in the part, as we just read in Ephesians, that each one of us has to offer and to play and to be an integral aspect of the life of this family of Christ. We ask now that you would take your word, which is already true, living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, and whatever studies I have done and gifts that you have given me and anointing that your Holy Spirit can render, take all of that, blend it together so that each of us might receive the word. It might not only come into us, but we get into it, and then we go into a world and offer hope and life and peace that is found in Christ Jesus alone. We thank you for this time. In his name, amen. Life happens here. You say, well, duh, that's kind of obvious. Life happens here. But still, even those things in life that are a given doesn't mean that they are not significant. And it is significant that life happens here. And therefore, we're going to commence this morning a four-part sermon series by that simple title that you see there, Life Happens Here. And I'm going to suggest to you over the course of these 4 weeks that living things grow, living things flow, living things glow, and living things go. So let's start this morning with the very first, that living things grow. Grow. Now, as you are aware, I am the greatest basketball player in the history of the world. And so when I was a young man working on such, I remember lying in bed saying to myself, now, Stan, for your game to really excel, you need to be about 6'9". And so I was convinced that somewhere between 6'7 and 6'9 was the optimum size for my game to really express itself. And I can remember as a young person lying in bed trying to make myself grow. Now I can't even grow hair. Your body sheds between 30,000 and 40,000 old skin cells every day. The skin you see now will be gone in about a month. Dead skin cells are on top. In each one of us sitting in this room, there are between 18 and 23 layers of skin that we see that is made up of dead cells. Over the course of the lifetime, all of the skin that you lose will add up to roughly half your body weight. Pass the donuts, I'm making up for lost cells. Living things grow. That's a given. But here's a philosophical, an epistemological question as much as anything. How do you know when you grow? For that matter, if living things grow, then to know that you are alive, you have to know that you grow. So how do you know when you grow? Or more fundamentally, how do you even know when you're alive? Think about it. You've never been dead, so you don't know what that is like. And so all you've got to go on is what you're experiencing now. And how do you really know that you are alive? Well, that raises the issue, and we're going to wrestle with it this morning, of what we might call signs of life. NASA spends billions of your dollars and mine searching for signs of life on the moon and Mars. In a hospital room, the doctor watches carefully the monitor beside the patient's bed for beep, beep, or a flat line. It raises the issue that you see on the screen of vital signs. We're always having to monitor those vital signs that help us know, are we growing? How are we growing? And what I'm going to share with you this morning, straight from the Word of God, is going to be some vital signs that will help you personally and us corporately to measure our own life and to see how we are growing, or whether we are, as it were, going the other direction. And if you're not growing, you're not living. And if you're not living, you are, you understand where I'm going with this. So out of Ephesians chapter 4, the passage you heard Shirley read, we will look and see five vital signs of eternal life, of abundant life, which Jesus said that's part and parcel of the Christian experience. So we'll see in the body of Christ, and for you personally and me, five vital signs that we can therefore from this day on measure ourselves and say, am I growing and how much am I growing? Here we go. We'll just simply work through them. This is basically a good old-fashioned teaching Bible study, as it were. The first is supreme loyalty. Loyalty. Working closely with the passage, I again remind you, keep your Bible in front of you because we'll be very close to it, and you want to make sure you hear more from God than you do from me. So therefore, look at verse 15 in Ephesians chapter 4. It speaks about Christ, who is the head. Him, who, the actual wording is, him who is the head, comma, Christ. Now, in the original language in which that was written, there's a grammatical little tool, trick, that they use there to place the emphasis upon the subject. And that subject is Jesus Christ. It raises an issue that I believe I preached in this pulpit when I was here in January on a one Sunday experience. And I preached about the supremacy of Christ, the preeminence of Christ. That's a big deal theologically. The preeminence, the supremacy of Christ. You may remember a few weeks ago, I quoted a pastor in Honolulu, and he speaks about this, and he reminds us that he is large and in charge. Now, to understand our Bibles, when we read the book of Ephesians, there is another epistle in the New Testament, very similar to it, written to a similar audience in a relatively near locale, Colossians, in the church at Colossae. So Ephesians and Colossians are somewhat similar. They deal with the same topics, but give different slants or different light on it. So if we go to Colossians chapter 1, we'll hear Paul use the same verbiage, but say it a bit differently and flesh it out a bit more. It's appropriate for us now. Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 through 18. And these references are in the outline that Suzanne so dutifully avails to you in the course of the week. Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 through 18. He, meaning Jesus, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is also the head of the body, the church, and he is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself will come to have first place in everything. Is there any part of that we don't understand? Coaches will often say to their team, be sure you play for the name on the front of the jersey and not the one on the back. You understand what they're saying? Be about something that is bigger, better, and beyond you as an individual. Decide where your ultimate loyalty lies, what your cause is in life, what is the number one issue here. So therefore, the first vital sign of life indicating that we're alive and growing is when Jesus is Lord, not just Savior, Lord of our lives and of our, his church. The second vital sign is superior unity. Unity. Please spend time with verse 13. Here Paul says, until we all, listen to that word, until we all attain to the unity of the faith. And how does that happen? He tells us in verse 15, Christ, from whom we are held together. Without Christ, we cannot have unity. Now, biblically, unity, not uniformity, is a big deal. Mutiny will sink a ship, and it will torpedo a church. Therefore, there are more than 20 passages in the New Testament alone that specifically address the topic of unity within the body of Christ. I have referenced before in the time that I have spent here this season, Jesus' priestly prayer in John chapter 17. And in that prayer, of the myriad of topics that Jesus covers, he prays about one specific matter 5 times. Do you know what it is? That they may be one, 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 that they may be one. It's a big deal. Now, the basis of our unity is not platitude, humanistic ideals, or wishful thinking, even clever slogans. Here's we're told where our unity comes from, and to get that, we go back into Ephesians chapter 2, same epistle, and in the second chapter, Paul says that there are Jews and Gentiles, and in that time, in that place, that was a big division between peoples. And he says, Christ has come and broken down the dividing wall between the two, and then in verse 14, Ephesians 2:14, he himself is our peace. He himself is our peace. And again, that same clever trick in the original language is used to emphasize Jesus, and nothing but Jesus is what we have in common. He is our peace. Permit me to illustrate. As you know, I've been in ministry full-time after school for 40 years now. And I know some of you are thinking, well, we'd like for that experience to pay off pretty soon, Hankins. It's time for you to get with it. But nonetheless, for the first 15 years of my ministry, I was a local pastor in churches in the islands. Last 25 years as an evangelist and so forth. Okay. I was a member, and I still hold my ordination and ministerial standing, in the Hawaii Conference United Church of Christ. You may have heard of the UCC. And so I'm still in good standing, sort of, with the United Church of Christ. Now, if they knew I was here right now, they might have some indigestion. If you're watching online, aloha. Well, nonetheless, for those first, particularly those first 15 years, and over the last 25 years, about every 12 or 15 years, I'll go to one of their conference gatherings, you know, one of their big meetings, their synods or whatever it's called. But I, when I was a local pastor, I had to go to those all, I'm sorry, I went to those all the time, and I participated. And as you know, in the islands, we are an intensely multi-ethnic society. That's just part and parcel. So I noticed with that group that the United Church of Christ, which we know is a theologically, I'm not talking about politically, but you could, but that is a theologically extremely liberal group, right? What does that mean? That means that they could care less about the Bible, we'll never mention sin, and Jesus, a little bit of this, a little bit of that, and salvation, what's that? Okay, is that a fair, accurate description of theological liberalism? Without any axe to grind, just telling you what it is. Okay, with that in mind, we would have our conference meetings, and in this multi-ethnic place, regularly, they would stress that the theme of this year is ho'olokahi, lokahi, unity. All these multi-ethnic people would gather, and they would talk about how we are one. We are one. I am here to tell you, in 40 years, I never once heard them tell us what makes us one. All they did was say, we are unified, we are one, because we say so. Talk about Jesus. You can tell I get wound up about this stuff. Tell us how we are unified. Tell us how we can break down divisions and walls between us. He himself is our peace. Husband and wife, if you genuinely can't see eye to eye, look to Jesus. He himself is our peace. How does this apply to you and me today in the world in which we live? Okay. If you are Republican and the other is Democrat, but we are in Christ, then we are one. If one is black and the other is white, and we are saved by the blood, then we are family. If one of us is Baptist and the other is Reformed, but we worship the same Savior, then we are siblings. If one is traditional and the other is contemporary, but we are worshiping the same Savior, we're operating from the same heartbeat. The second sign of life, not negotiable, is when we are one. Thirdly, signs of life, vital signs, is a steady maturity. Maturity. Again, we go into our passage and we look at verse 14. And in verse 14, Paul says, now look, we're striving that you might become the mature man. Hear those words, mature man. Let me explain to you about a coconut tree. We have a lot of coconut trees where I live. And an amazing thing happens with a coconut tree. You can have, they stand typically, yeah, about as tall as this ceiling that we have here when they're full grown. Do not walk under a coconut tree, and we used to have to spend $1,000 a year cleaning the trees. Now it would be $5,000 because the tourists wouldn't quit parking under the coconut trees. Goodness, it was out of our church budget. Now, we did not have to spend money on heating and air conditioning, which this church does not spend enough money on heating, I'm here to tell you. Every day, Suzanne and I are fighting with one of us in the office about the thermostat. I'm always hitting that up button, and somebody else comes in and goes down, 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 down. Well, we won't go there, will we? Anyway, with coconut trees, if a mite gets in there and kills the tree, or a hurricane comes in and damages the tree and so forth, what happens is this. A coconut tree grows and is alive only as a new kikal. You learn that word? Kikal means the little frond that comes out of the top. As long as those are being produced, the tree is alive. If something has happened to damage that tree, you can still see the beautiful palm fronds. You can see the coconuts up there. It can sway wonderfully in the trade winds. It is dead as a doornail because it's not growing. It's not maturing. Maturity is an essential topic that numerous scriptures address. Those scriptures condemn immaturity and use biting language of being immature, carnal babies for Christians. Likewise, there are wonderful passages that laud growth and maturity, such as 2 Peter 3:18, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So please understand what this means. You can be in church all your life. You can have made a commitment to Christ when you were a young person decades ago. But if you are not growing in your faith and your walk with Jesus, growing in grace, then frankly, we remain a spiritual babe. So I would ask you this morning, are you growing? How? Be specific with yourself to say, here's what I can point to that says I am growing in my walk with the Lord. In the passage, Paul does us a wonderful favor because that may be so nebulous that you just can't work with it. So he helps us out and he gives us two measures, a blueprint, a template by which to say, you want to know what maturity looks like? In this passage, I'll give you two. They are the stature of Christ and stability of walk. Let's go to our passage, verse 13. Paul says, in these marks of maturity, the stature of Christ, I want you to grow into a mature man to the measure of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. Simply put, you and I, as we walk with the Lord, should look, act, sound, and smell like Jesus. Second is our stability of our walk. Look at verse 14 in your Bible you have open in front of you. We are no longer to be children, tossed here and there by waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine. by the trickery of men, by craftiness and deceitful scheming. That means that we develop, the longer we walk with the Lord, the more we stay in His Word, the more sensitive we are to the leading of His Holy Spirit. Then we have the ability to quickly discern truth from error. And to be able to, not only doctrinally, but to be able to sniff out anything and anyone who ethically is fudging on propriety and truth. We get a discerning eye. Hebrews talks about those who are so saturated in the Word that they're able to discern between good and evil, having their senses trained. And let me add one more to this business of stability of our walk in the Lord. My experience and my understanding is that the longer you walk with Jesus, that it should make an impact on how stable you are, meaning that the roller coaster may begin to flatten out a little bit. Yes, we will all experience ups and downs, but as you are stronger in Christ, perhaps they won't be quite the highs and the lows. And I could say it simply, how about we all ask the Lord to give us a little less emotion and a little more devotion, that we're just stable in Christ. The third sign of life, frankly, is when you act your stage. Fourthly, spiritual activity, vital signs, spiritual activity, activity. Notice verse 16. Paul says, I want you to have the proper working. And the word there for working is the word energeia, which means energies, flowing energy. We talk a lot about energy in our election cycles. Okay, the proper energies of each, the proper working of each individual part. Simply put, the Christian faith is a participatory sport. It was years ago in seminary. Yes, I can remember being in seminary. And as was typically the case, I slithered into class and promptly put myself on the back row and was going to sleep through the whole thing. That's how you do this. And that day, unusually, we had a guest speaker. And it was a little man from Africa. So our professor introduced this little guy from Africa, and he got up and started to talk, and I woke up, which was a miracle in and of itself. And so he gets up and he says, you need the church in Africa. The church in Africa needs you. Good night. I paid money for this. And then he went on. He said, where I live in Africa, there was a man who came to hunt on a safari. And one day in the village in the jungle area where we live, we heard a shot ring out through the jungle. And we heard a crash to the ground, and we realized an elephant had been shot. The entire village left what we were doing and ran to where the shot had occurred. And we saw the elephant, and immediately all of us began to go and get vines and tie it onto the elephant and onto the trunk and around the elephant. And together we were chanting, our elephant, our elephant, our elephant. And he said, the hunter from afar saw this, and he was outraged. And he went and he stood in front of us, and he shot into the air saying, hey, what are you talking about, our elephant? This is my elephant. I shot it. He said, we Africans looked at him. We looked at one another. We dropped our vines, walking away chanting, your elephant, your elephant, your elephant. The hunter was so proud of himself. And he said, yes, my elephant. And then and he said, within a few minutes, we saw the same Bwana show up into our village saying, excuse me, would you like to come help us move our elephant? And he finished by saying, the church in Africa needs you. You need the church in Africa. That truth still resonates today. The fourth sign of vital sign of life, abundant life, is when we are involved. The fifth and final is sustained elasticity. I like that word, elasticity. Look at verse 16. The proper working of each individual part causes the growth of the body for the building up of itself in love. In other words, there's a number of action things going on there that when the body, everybody's doing their part, it naturally produces growth and improvement and building up. Think about this. A body of believers like us is either developing or decaying. Second law of thermodynamics, entropy. Entropy means that everything on the planet is in a constant state of decay. Don't believe me? Look in the mirror. I did this morning. It's very difficult. Things are either developing or they are decaying. And so I ask you, Bex, which is it? Better or brittle? Let that carefully chosen word stick in your craw. Brittle. The fifth sign of life is when we expand, we stretch, we are flexible, we are pliable. Some of you in this room have had, will have, surgery where they repair joints and this, that, and the other. What's the first thing they do? They cut you open, they wake you up, and then they say, get up and get moving. Why? Flexibility. Got to get things working. That's what Paul is talking about here. The fifth sign of life is when we bend, but don't break. Well, life happens here. And there are five ways we can know that we are alive. And we know we are alive when we are growing. And we know we are growing when we see loyalty, when we embody loyalty, unity, maturity, activity, and elasticity. I started off by asking a difficult philosophical question. How do you know when you are growing? Now you know. Let's pray. Lord, you are the giver of life. Sometimes we take it for granted. And we realize that we cannot make ourselves grow in our walk with you. But we do recognize, however, that we can stunt our growth both personally and corporately. Forgive us and fix us. And that will give us amazing hope and optimism, because in Christ, we can be on the grow. Amen and amen.
Let's all stand together, and as we sing hymn number 355, Trusting Jesus.
Trusting Jesus, that is all.
it amazing that you don't have to consciously try to be alive? You just live. So let the Lord work in you and through you, and in my case, in spite of you, and experience life. Why? Because life happens here. And when you go from here, then life happens there. Knock yourself out. Let's pray together. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you that we are about hope, promise, victory, life. And we ask you to empower us and enthuse us. We ask you here in this place where life happens, that God would move in ways that we do not expect, in ways that we cannot predict, and in ways that we dare not restrict. Amen. Randy's ready for us to go. Let's do this.